very good morning. Good to see so many familiar faces. I guess I'm Ben. For those who don't know me, I actually prof here. Interesting thing is that I'm actually it's not working, but okay. I'm actually familiar with this particular lecture hall. I've been teaching here. I mean, I haven't been teaching here for a while, but let's see. Okay, but this is me about 6 years ago. So I'm sort of a Jedi Master. Okay, my superpower is torturing students. Okay, so I've been in NUS torturing undergrads for quite a few years. So let me tell a bit of a story. So today, the topic I've been asked to talk about is, Mr. Gee, thank you for inviting me. You asked me to come and talk about something, you know. And I was thinking about what to say, like, you know, he suggested talking about, you know, teaching adults, right, which is an interesting topic today, given that we are worried about skill future and things like that, right? So, all right, so let me tell you a bit of a story about what I've been doing at NUS. Okay, so, you know, when you talk about war, right, there's this, you go to, you know, in the nation days, fight war, this thing called Vanguard, I mean, it's the guys that, you know, when you go to war, right, they run first, die first, okay, that was me, okay. So about 4 years ago, NUS decided to do the following. So basically, NS was shortened to 2 years, from 2.5 years. So in the past, the girls were idling for about half a year before they go to school, right? Now, equal misery, the boys also idling, right? Okay. So in order to try to basically help them not waste more time, okay, what NUS did was that we decided to bring forward some of the classes, the intro classes, into the January period, right? So that, you know, these kids can actually start school earlier. And of course, finish earlier. Okay, so we have this thing called the NUS iBlock, okay, which is an interesting kind of 6-month course in the following format. So the course code was called FC, now it's called X. Alright. So the key idea is that in this new thing that was started 4 years ago, okay, all lectures were recorded. Alright. The first 3 months of class is the 6. Okay, normally the NUS semester is 13 weeks long. Okay. But what we did for these boys is that we have instead of doing teaching in 13 weeks, we teach over 6 months. Okay, the first 3 months, everything is taught online. Okay, the lectures are recorded, and we also have online tutorials taught using WebEx. Okay, reason is very simple, because this is actually January, before the school starts. So many of the boys are actually still in NS. Okay, and the way it works is a bit random. You know, some finish earlier, some finish later. Okay, but because, you know, some have finished, some have not. Okay, for fairness, there's equal misery. So all cannot come to class. Okay, in case some come to class, some cannot come to class, they complain, right? So first 3 months, nobody comes to class, everything's online. Next 3 months, actually, the kids come back to class. Okay, they come to school, and we have lessons. The tension is actually to have them, you know, get used to the school environment, get used to coming to class, right? And then final exam is in June. So this was something that happened 4 years ago, and I'm still teaching this class right now, okay? So the problem is this. The problem that I dealt with or had to worry about was very simple. You know, you're all teachers, mostly teachers, right? Okay. You know, students don't like to do homework. Who still like to do homework? Let me know. Don't have, right? So the problem is this, you know. You see them, right? They don't do homework, okay? For 3 months, first 3 months, I don't see them. Even worse, right? Confirm walk, game over, right? And actually, the thing is that the dynamics of you know, students not being physically present is quite different. Okay, so I think teachers don't really know, because you all still see the students every day, right? In fact, you see them too much, right? All right. So for me, the problem was the converse, which is that, you know, the students don't come to class. We don't see them, so I'm concerned. So anyway, my solution was that I built this thing, which is called Cosmology, which Kelvin sort of talked briefly about. I'll talk a bit more later about that. Okay, so that was something happened that 4 years ago, right? Now, it turns out that after being mastering the torturing of undergrads, okay, in the spirit of skills future, must upgrade, right? Okay, so we upgrade to torturing teachers instead. Okay, so basically, you know, so after the first, after so about actually 3 years ago, okay, actually for 3 years, okay, I was given the honorable job of torturing teachers. How cool is that? All right. So these are them, some of the faces you can actually recognize in this lecture. So how cool is that? And you know that they are very traumatized, because our Kelvin got it wrong. It's only 10-month course. He said 11. Because, you know, as Chinese saying, it's called 度日如年, which means that it's so painful that every day feels like a year. Right, so he taught 11 months, actually only 10 months. Okay, let me correct him there. Okay, so it is, I think that the, you know, he's mentally really very, very affected. So 10 months, okay. Technically, MOE.
How many hundred days of torture?
I quite a lot, okay. I lost count, but it was 10, no, but not so bad. We instead of, okay, so instead of torturing people, there are many ways to do it. You can do it, you know, acutely, which is like you go and, you know, poke him, you know, keep stabbing him. Or you can do it, okay, in a chronic way, which is called death by 1,000 cuts. So we don't do it, you know, one time do a lot. We do one day, 1 week only. One week, one day only. Okay, so they come in for 10 months, okay, every week come to get tortured. Okay? So that's what we did. Okay, and then essentially we actually kind of teach them pattern programming. We also cover some topics. Okay, and the reality is this, I mean, it's really painful to go and start a new course. Currently I'm not so free. So what we actually did was that we inflicted the 10x materials that I had already prepared on them. Because the reality is that, so the lectures were actually taken from the 10x course that I had, FC course that I just, you know, done with the NS boys. Okay, it turned out quite okay well. Okay, so they're still alive here, which is a good thing. So the key torture is that, you know, make them suffer and feel a lot of pain, but don't kill them. Kill them, already no teachers left to teach, right? Okay, so it was good. So they survived 3 years. I'm done with that right now. And the way we did was that first 2 years, we basically trained the O-level teachers. Okay, and last year, we actually taught the A-level teachers so that you have your 10 JCs. First time I meet him, I complain. I mean, my prof, my boys, my girls, you know, after they finish O-levels, got nowhere to go. Okay, so we dealt with that. Okay, so I now got two hands full, right? Okay, so it's not bad. Okay, good. Then the spectate exam as well. Okay, now then what happened last year? Okay, so I told you, Vanguard, go first, die first. So last year, NUS announced this thing called the Lifelong Learning Program, okay? Which means what? Which means that we will let the alumni come back and take classes, right? This is last year in announced, okay? It was in the news, okay? And basically, again, I went first, So basically now the question is, can we transform CS10X, okay? Which is the Python class I've been teaching for LLI, which is Lifelong Learning, okay? Initiative, right? So interestingly, okay, NUS announced 800 students sign up, right? 800 alumni sign up, right? Well, guess what? I got 80 of them, okay. So I'm the biggest. So 800 is divided all over NUS, But among 800, I got 80 of them, okay. So basically, I'm the biggest shareholder, okay. All right. So this is what happened. So 80 signed up. How many survived? I'll tell you later. Okay. So first thing is that Okay, so the point is this. Originally in 10x, right, our presentations were not online. It means basically, if I have anything online, I mean, presentation online only the first 3 months, okay? But alumni actually had some issues, which is that coming, okay, I kind of accommodate 280 people somewhere in US, okay? So what we did was that we moved all the presentations online for every class, okay, for the whole 6 months instead of the first 3 months, okay? The second thing is that we actually recorded all the recitations and tutorials. Okay. Now, in the past, we always had live classes because at some level, I want to encourage them to come to class online, okay, or in the classroom. But at 280 students, okay, so I have 280 of this alumni. I also have another 70 of the undergrads, Hannes Mann. I have another 180 or so, 100 from LQI School of Public Policy. So I have just 4 students to deal with. I just couldn't deal with them physically. So essentially everything was online. And when online, actually I can't even have enough. If I schedule live online teaching, I can't even fit 400. So we have to record everything. Okay, so this is what we did. Okay, now let me just take a kind of a digression and talk about something that's really quite, that I've been thinking about. Okay. I don't know, I mean, the last few years, this thing is all about this thing about MOOCs, right? Okay, but after the MOOC kind of hype, right? There's also this thing about MOOCs don't really work. Okay, really, I mean, MOOCs actually don't really work. If you look at the numbers, it's a lot of humongous numbers, but actually percentage of people finishing is very low, 5% or so. Okay, so of course the question is why not, I mean, right? Anybody has any insights? Don't care. Okay, anyway, I'm thinking about this problem. So the problem I have is this. I mean, online learning is not new. Okay, MIT has had open courseware for 20 years. Not so bad response, but not great, right? So the question is, why do online platforms fail? Okay. Then I look at my own teaching. I've been okay successful at teaching students, you know. So the question I have was, okay, so what's different? Between physically teaching them and teaching them online. I was thinking to myself, am I more efficient online, right? Okay. Well, this is what I think. Okay. So it turns out that my view about teaching is interesting. And this is some level alluded to by Calvin earlier, which is falling, right? Teaching is actually not the transmission of information. Okay. Unlike what people think. I mean, I think the new teachers, the kind of newbies will think, oh, teaching is just about communicating information, making them know stuff, right? But rubbish, huh? Okay. Teaching fundamentally is actually like Jedi, it's called Jedi Mind Tricks. It's about the power of managing motivations and understanding how they think so that they do what they don't want, what's good for them, but they don't want to do, but they still do. Okay? All right. So this is really about that, right? And then actually the secret of this thing is that learning is actually social. Alright. So what reasons of us as teachers succeeding or when we succeed is really because oftentimes we're able to connect to the students, with the students. Okay, and sadly that's why actually teaching is not very scalable because it's actually quite a lot of effort. Okay, so the point is teaching is social. Okay, and I realized that actually online platforms fail fundamentally because where you transition from the physical classroom to the online classroom, right? What is lost is the social part. Okay, I don't know whether you read this kinds of the wuxia kind of novels. Okay, then for the non-Chinese friends, they're translating to English already. Okay. There's this very famous novel. It's called the Condor Hero thing. Okay, this guy called Yang Kuo, right? Basically, he's one hand chopped off and then he can still fight. Okay, the problem is this. The problem for me when I transition from the normal classroom teaching into this online mode, right? Is what? Is that I feel like Yang Kuo. I mean, like my one arm chopped off. Then I'm like, I need to learn to fight again with my one arm and fight better than before. So how, right? Okay, so before that, let me show you how we sort of got it done this year. Okay, and actually the interesting thing about the current thing that I'm doing with the alumni is this. Okay, I have fully transitioned into no more classroom teaching already. Okay, we are able to teach alumni, 100% online. They only turn up for exams. Because we proctor the exam, make sure it's not no cheating, right? So I transitioned into 100% fully online teaching. And interestingly, I'm torturing them as effectively as before. Okay, so how do we do this? Okay, and I think many of you know cosmology, but I think you have not seen some of the new innovations we've done to make this work. Okay, so let me just quickly show you how we did that. Okay, so some of you are familiar with this, but this is cosmology for you. Okay, and this is a real class. Okay, this is a real class that's going on now. There are people doing stuff. Okay, I just made an announcement. And of course, every year got some crazy student who does some crazy stuff. Okay, who's far ahead of everybody else. Okay, so first thing you realize is this. Now the time is about 11 o'clock, right? And it's very active now. Okay, so you can see from here that I have practical exams next Saturday because all kanchong practicing already. Okay, so you go in the system, you see there's an activity feed and you see that there's people doing stuff. Okay, now so the thing is that when the students come into this page, right, they realize that they're not alone, right? Okay, so people are actually doing stuff. So there's a sense of action or community. It's not some dead wall. Okay, now that cosmology, let me explain also to you, is that it is not like the be-all and all system. Cosmology is really what? It's really a homework system. Okay, it's there to set homeworks, okay, to have students submit homeworks, and have it easy, and auto-grading so that we don't do work. That is the key. And the secret of cosmology is very simple, is that the auto-grading is very powerful, so much so that every year you add a few more questions. After a while, okay, the system now has a lot of questions. Okay, so for first of all, let's look at the homework system. Okay, in case you haven't seen it before, okay, we call it missions, okay, and let's take a look at some random thing. Let's say there's a lot of homework, a lot of homework. Okay, let's look at some submissions. Okay. Alright, so this is the homework system. This is all the homework files. The students put in the code here, right? And then there's autograder which grades all of them, okay? But the most important thing that is interesting to see here is, hopefully I can find something here, okay? So what's happened is this, actually, when the students make a mistake, right? Okay, my tutors can actually comment, okay, and actually tell the student exactly which line they're wrong, okay? At the bottom of every question, there's a Facebook-like feed that lets the students communicate with the tutors. Okay, this is a very important social element. Okay, so basically, with this kinds of auto-grading, okay, plus the communication with tutors, okay, what happens is that we also have a control center here whereby I can see all the comments that's going on in the system. Okay, and it lets me monitor the all the communications, okay, and lets the students engage the teaching staff. Okay, so this is part of the social parts, okay. And then there's also, of course, the forums, okay, where, you know, they can ask questions. I can see that the over here there's a question mark, so there's unresolved questions. Typically, I'll leave it for a while, you know, and let some of the students take care of it. If after a while nobody deals with it for enough, long enough, I deal with it. Okay, but what's actually new is this. So now the way it works in this class is the following, is that it's a lesson plan. Okay, we're very late in the lesson plan, but suppose you are here, right? There's a lecture, and lecture, all lectures are recorded, okay? And of course, some of you have seen this before, but let's look at this. So you go to here, okay? The system now basically has an embedded video, okay? But next to the video actually is a feed as well, right? So the truth is that as a student watches the video and then doesn't understand something, he or she can post a comment here, and then when I click on the timing, right, it scrolls to exact point in time whereby, you know, there's a kind of like clarity problem, right? We can address it then. Okay, students will see the same thing later and have the same problems will see the answer, okay? And all these things are also fed into the command center here, okay? So basically, this allows us to address all these concerns. So what I'm showing you are the social parts of this entire system that's really powerful, that's going to work. All right, and of course, as I mentioned, it's actually also a kind of a gamified system, okay, whereby there's a leaderboard, okay? Okay, so we can show every student, okay? But for us, we only show the first few, okay? Because we are afraid of embarrassing the bottom, okay? But he's very even more brutal than me, so he's trying to basically exceed, surpass me as the evil prof, well done, okay? All right, so basically, these are some of the kind of key things that we have put in, okay, to kind of enable, to improve the thing. Okay, so I tell you a few more things. So I've taught teachers for 3 years, okay, and I've taught also now I'm teaching the alumni. The teachers actually, for all the complaints, not so bad, no? Because we actually got MOE to agree to give them 1 day a week, at least on paper, Okay, at least on paper. They always say, just prof, you know, bluff one. My principal made me work book my rest of my 5 days in the 4 days. I also know, but I sympathize. But, you know, at least on paper, the schools are supposed to, you know, give the teachers 1 day a week to focus on studies. Okay, the alumni don't have such, you know, privilege. They're taking class on their own time. Okay, and the other thing is that, and of course, there are a lot of problems. I mean, there's no time, you know, got family, got husband, got wives. Got work, right? Okay. Basically, there's also another problem with online teaching in this level is that the kind of the ability and disparity is very, very huge. Okay. Some are very fast, some are not so fast. Okay. So this is actually very challenging. All right. And these are the things that we have. So as I to say again, okay, so we have this to make it more social and make sure that the people feel drawn in. Okay. They have this activity feeds, right? The platform messaging, you talk to the tutors. The annotation of code, I tell you which line is wrong. There's a forum, there's also gamification. Okay, and the funny thing that I want to say here is that although it sounds like it's so good to have an online system, actually it's a lot of work. Okay, and Kelvin will know, actually it's a lot of work. Right. So the truth is that even though we have the system supporting customized design, especially support the whole entire workflow, it still involves a lot of work. Right? My point to all my fellow teachers here is that unfortunately, you know, teaching is actually a costly profession. We do it because we care. We do it because that's the right thing to do, okay? But it's actually a lot of work. Okay, so the next question that people will ask is this, and I think it's very scary, because how many of you are online teachers? Don't have, right? All classroom teachers, right? Correct, right? The first question is that, does it work or not, right? Okay, you would think it may not work, okay? So let me just show you some data, okay? So this is me trying this out, doing this. Basically, first year, don't know anything. I'm gonna try, go first, die first, right? But it's not so bad, no? Look at the results, Okay, so 10% of students, the kind of paikia, don't turn up at all. Just don't attend class online, just don't attend. They don't even give excuse, don't attend, right? 10% paikia, right? 20% tell me, okay, they prefer face-to-face, okay? 60% tell me prefer recordings. Actually, this one completely wrong one, completely fake, I tell you why. Because first year, I had technical problem, okay? The recording made me start Mickey Mouse. Cannot possibly be better one. No way in hell is better, okay? But it's still 6-6. So this one, I suspect a problem, okay? Because, I don't know why women really like Mickey Mouse, okay? But that year, confirmed there's a problem with recordings because I had some technical issues, okay? Now, 35% said it was bearable for convenience, which means what? Which means that they thought that, okay, physics wasn't better, but because they can now attend my class in pyjamas, you know, eat while I talk, right? They are quite happy, okay? 4% think no difference. Okay, they think online class, physics class, same. And 60% thought it was better than, I was just surprising to me, okay? I expected the last thing to be zero, right? You also think so, right? Okay, why do you do things? Because even though you don't think it was effective, because I have no choice. Because I had logistic constraints. I just can't drag them to class, right? So it's not bad already. That first year I did this. Actually, 20% felt was not bad because it's actually as good or better than physical, correct? Okay. Then now this year is what? 2018 already, right? Okay. So 5 years later, you know, hopefully a bit smarter, lah. Okay. So it turns out that this year was more paikia, okay? 50% don't turn up, okay? But okay, a lot of alumni, okay? So maybe they don't think I had some enough online, so they don't come up, okay, never mind, okay? But interestingly, face-to-face is now 15%, okay, better, okay? 12% prefer recordings, which is actually, this year is quite believable because records are quite good, okay? Because we actually went to redo our recordings properly, and actually the records are all higher quality because they're more skilled, okay? So this 12% we prefer is actually okay. 25% think it's bearable for convenience, okay? Interesting story is this, that no difference has risen to 19%, okay? And WebEx better has dropped a little bit, but I think the drop is not statistically significant, right? So the reality is now, the current reality we have achieved is that one-third thinks that online is as good or better, okay? One-third thinks that it's not really better, but because I know I don't have to travel to school, it's okay. And actually only 15% thinks that face-to-face is better, the rest you don't know because they don't chat. Okay, so the reality is that I have proven over the last 5 years we can actually do this. And another story is that they also take that this alumni take the same exams as my undergrads, and they're actually quite good for those who survived. Okay. So this is a random thing I share with you. You know, this is a student of mine who actually this is last year, right? So she transitioned from a online version to a face-to-face one, and she said that actually it's not bad. She missed online classes because she feels it's more personal. It's a greater interaction. Okay, the thing about online class is this, because they're all kind of one list, right? What I do is I just go down, everybody gets to talk, you know, in sequence, okay? Whereas face-to-face, sometimes you don't have this kind of time. Okay, they say it's convenient, videos, okay, whatever. Okay, now, so this is the thing that I'll share with you, okay? The question is that, is it working out? Okay, I must tell something also. Although I started 280 of them, not all survived. Okay, so currently, I think about 70 students are now continuing the class. Okay, and actually, the truth is that it's not that, you know, there's anything wrong. Okay, what they found and what we found is that actually my class is very xiong. Right? The teacher will correct xiong. Who thinks it's xiong? I don't think my class xiong, right? Okay, so the problem is that really I think too much work. So many alumni cannot actually cope with the workload. Okay, and unfortunately, we have a schedule to meet because we have exams. Right? Okay. So basically, main problem from this teaching alumni is really very simple. Is this time not enough? Okay, so this is what we have found, or I found. Okay, but it's not actually bad. I think if you, I'm quite confident that if you actually go and survey the alumni that dropped out, they will not say that the class is bad or everything is wrong, right? They will just tell you that not enough time. Okay, I have made commitments. Okay, I didn't know what I signed up for. The MOE teacher is a bit different. All must pass because no choice. They fail MOE, you go after them. So they are quite, you know, motivated. Alumni, they sign up, they don't know why they sign up, they think it's free to sign up. Right. So the level of motivation to complete is also different. Okay. Now so I just end with this key insights that I have. Okay. Number one, okay. I think DLAs are very important. Okay. So one reason if you do the MOOC style where by own time target, you just go do anything, confirm fail one. Because the problem with online classes is motivation, okay? You got no deadlines, people just don't do stuff. So deadlines are very important, okay? But now we have a problem. The deadlines are too close. Basically, you get the homework, what they have is not enough to finish homework, so they give up, okay? So the key, and this is something that's going forward, is this. You need a different timeline for different students, which is makes sense, right? Okay, number one. Number two is obviously, we want to do that. We need to decouple the exams from the lessons. Okay, so let me show you a vision of the future. Okay, so you know, right? How many of you have downloaded files from the internet before? Download big files, right? Then you have downloaded big files. You got this image, the thing, the thing, there's this folder thing, spinning, whatever. Then they say, first they say, what, 20 minutes left, then 15 minutes left, then it changes to 18 minutes left, and so forth, right? Why? Well, because the truth is that the download speed will vary, right? Okay. So I tell you what's going to happen in the future. Okay. At least what I'm going to attempt is this. So basically, the idea is this. I have a schedule that is normal for everybody, same for everybody. All right. Then you start the class. Okay. Now, depending on how you actually, how fast you do, okay, what happens is that it's like downloading like that. So it's actually, the download time will change as you progress. So if you submit homework very fast, okay, the thing will be faster because you know it grew faster. On the other hand, if you find you struggling, right, then slowly, okay, the timeline will expand. Okay, so overall, basically, we try to have deadlines as well, so people have a sense of completion. Okay, but we expand and contract the timeline. Okay, and the other thing we'll do is to try to decouple the exams from the actual learning. Right, so basically, exams become like driving tests. Basically, you know, you have a fixed number of tests every year. Okay, you do your learning. Okay, you finish early, you wait with a driving test. Right, okay. And we can have more of this test. Okay, so I think the future of online learning for adults must be this kind of nature. Because if you have a normal fixed schedule kind of learning style, like the school system, like our NUS system, I think it's not going to work. All right, so that's all I have to share with you today. I hope it has been interesting. Questions? Yes?
Hey, why not? You talk about kind of managing motivation.
Yes.
You know, what about intrinsic motivation? I mean, it sounds like a lot of things that it's about kind of the external, like leaderboards and points and badges and things like that. What is the plan for creating internal motivation?
Excellent question. So I met my ex-students or teachers here. What do y'all think? Before the prof answers, let's see whether people actually learn something from Calvin. What do you think?
His prof Leong talked about one day where he made us suffer, right? But actually, the truth is that the other 5 days, my family had to suffer because along the way, my wife started saying things like, "Hey, I notice you are spending more time with Python than me."
Okay, so I need to address the question. I think you're absolutely right. That intrinsic motivation is the key. Okay, and actually I've written articles on this, and I think that the goal, the holy grail of all teachers is to actually have students actually love to learn the things. Okay, but I think the whole point is that it's a process. Okay, coding is actually quite hard. All right, so basically the problem is that they if you just throw them at it, they run to the wall. Right, so actually we need to scaffold them. Okay. We need to sort of, MOE has this thing called self-directed learning, right? Okay. But let me frame that a bit as teacher-directed self-directed learning. Okay. So the basic idea is as a teacher, you'll be clever, okay? About at least in the beginning for beginning learners, okay, to kind of push them along. Okay. The key thing is okay, if you look at my current cosmology thing, let me just refresh for you. Okay. Right. You notice that okay, just now I showed you a screen. Gabby is now sitting here trying to do her thing because she realizes that all her friends are doing a practice, right? So she's also ganjong trying to do already. So basically, I caught her doing that, right? So the point now is this. So these people are all, every point in time people are doing stuff, right? So they're all very motivated, right? Part of it is because the exam's coming, right? But you also have students exam coming, and it's actually quite early, This is actually more than 1 week before the exams. Okay, so I've actually made the students cram more than 1 week before the exams. Normally they do it 3 days before. Okay. So the reality is this, I think the you need to have started off with some level of torture so that they have some level of competency and mastery. Okay. I think intrinsic motivation for a subject can only come after you have some level of mastery and then you have a sense of that is interesting. So we spend a lot of time in the class actually developing very interesting assignments, right? Whereby we have one whereby it's Hunger Games whereby they run around, killing each other. Okay, it sounds kind of violent, but it's kind of cool, right? So you have just little things that go around killing people, killing other things, picking up stuff, and that's kind of cool. So if you have this kind of cool little things that they can do, and you ensure that they have the kind of scaffolds to reach the level of mastery, whereby they find interesting, then you can develop the intrinsic motivation. So I think the key to, let me ask you a question more clearly. I think the goal is intrinsic motivation, but I think you can't just have intrinsic motivation fall from the tree. So the way we do it is that we have this extrinsic motivation, make them do enough work, okay, develop mastery, okay, and from the mastery and autonomy, then they will develop this intrinsic motivation, which they have done. I know. Of course, exams help also. Okay? All right, I think I'm standing between you and lunch, so thank you very much for your time. We'll chat later. Thank you.